The Lives of the Saints by the Reverend Alban Butler, taken from the 4th edition, published in 1954. September 2nd, St. Stephen, King of Hungary. Geza, the 4th Duke of the Hungarians, by conversing with certain Christian captives, and afterwards with certain holy missionaries, as Pellegrinus, Bishop of Passau, St. Wolfgang, Bishop of Ratisbon, etc., or their disciples, became infinitely delighted with the sanctity of the maxims of our holy faith, and was convinced of its divine truth and original by the motives and arguments which are, as it were, the stamp which God has put upon his revelation in order to confirm it to us. And though he had reason to fear great disturbances from the ferocity of his people, upon a change of religion, he despised such dangers, and was baptized together with his wife Sarlot and several of his officers and courtiers. Sarlot was so penetrated with the wonderful mysteries of religion, and so strongly affected with the great ideas of eternity, that she walked in the paths of heroic perfection with a fervor not inferior to that of the saints. Being some time after with child, she was assured by St. Stephen the protomartyr in a dream that she bore in her womb a son who should complete the work she and her husband had begun, and abolish idolatry in that nation. The child was born in 977 at Gran, the ancient Strigonium, at that time the metropolis of this country, and on account of the above-mentioned vision was christened Stephen. St. Adalbert, Bishop of Prague, who for some time preached the gospel to the Hungarians, and according to the German historians, baptized St. Stephen, had certainly no small share in the honor of his education, and Theodatus, an Italian count of singular piety, was his tutor. Geza died in 997, and Stephen, who had been chosen waywode, that is, leader of the army, or duke, some time before then took the reins of the government into his hands. His first care was to settle a firm peace with all the neighboring nations. This being done, he turned his thoughts wholly to root out idolatry, and as much as in him lay to make Christ reign in the hearts of all his subjects. Performing himself the part of a missionary, he often accompanied the preachers and pathetically exhorted his people to open their eyes to the divine truth. Many, however, were so obstinately attached to the superstitions of their ancestors as to take up arms in defense of idolatry, and having at their head a count of great interest and valor named Zetzard, with a numerous army they laid siege to Vesprin. St. Stephen placed his confidence in the Lord of hosts and prepared himself for the engagement by fasting, almsdeeds, and prayer, invoking particularly the intercession of St. Martin and St. George. Though inferior to the rebels in the number of his forces, by the divine assistance, he gave them a total overthrow and slew their leader. The zealous prince founded the archbishopric of Gran, or Strigonium, and 10 bishoprics, and sent Astricus, or Anastasius, the new elected bishop of Kolox, to Rome, to obtain of Pope Sylvester II the confirmation of these foundations, and of many other things which he had done for the honor of God and the exaltation of his holy church, and at the same time to beseech his holiness to confer upon him the title of king, which his subjects had long pressed him to assume, and which he now only asked to satisfy their desires, and that he might with more majesty and authority accomplish his great designs for promoting the glory of God and the good of his people. Mieczysław, Duke of Poland, upon marrying a Christian princess, the daughter of Boleslas, Duke of Bohemia, had embraced the faith in 965. About 34 years after this, he sent an embassy to Rome to obtain the title of king, confirmed to him by the authority of the Apostolic See. Sylvester II, who was then Pope, was disposed to grant his request, and prepared a rich crown to send him with his blessing. But the extraordinary zeal, piety, and wisdom of St. Stephen, deserving the preference, His Holiness delivered this crown for him to his ambassador, Astrik, together with a present of a cross, granting by a special privilege that it should be carried before him in his armies. At the same time, he, by a bull, confirmed all the religious foundations which our holy prince had made, and the elections of the bishops. St. Stephen went to meet his ambassador upon his return, listened standing, with great respect to the Pope's bulls whilst they were read, and fell on his knees as often as the name of His Holiness was repeated. The good prince, by a public act and with extraordinary devotion, declared that he put all his dominions under the special patronage of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and never ceased most earnestly offering his daily prayers to implore her powerful intercession for obtaining the divine blessing upon all his subjects. Whence in many medals and coins of the kingdom she is styled Patroness of Hungary. At Alba he built a stately church in honor of the Mother of God, in which the kings of Hungary were afterwards both crowned and buried. St. Stephen, who would seek no alliance but by which piety might be strengthened in his realm and family, took to wife Gisela, sister to St. Henry, King of Germany, who was shortly after crowned emperor, and that holy prince admirably seconded and assisted our saint in all his pious designs. St. Stephen abolished many barbarous and superstitious customs derived from the ancient Scythians, and by severe punishments repressed blasphemy, murder, theft, adultery, and other public crimes. To put a stop to incontinence and idolatry, he commanded all persons to marry except religious and churchmen, and forbade all marriages of Christians with idolaters. He was of most easy access to people of all ranks, and listened to everyone's complaints without distinction or preference, except that he appeared most willing to hear the poor, knowing them to be more easily oppressed, and considering that in them we honor Christ, who being no longer among men on earth, in his mortal state to receive from us any corporeal services, has substituted and recommended to us the poor in his place and right. The good king provided for their subsistence throughout his whole kingdom, and took them, especially the helpless orphans and widows, under his special protection, declaring himself their patron and father. One day it happened that, whilst he was dealing about his plentiful alms in disguise, a troop of beggars set upon him, threw him down, beat him, plucked him by the beard and hair, and took away his purse, seizing for themselves what he intended for the relief of many others. The king esteemed himself happy to suffer in the service of his Redeemer, and addressed himself in these words to the Blessed Virgin. "See, O Queen of Heaven, in what manner I am requited by those that belong to your Son, my Divine Savior. As they are his friends, I receive with joy this treatment from their hands." He learned, however, from this accident no more to expose his person, but he renewed his resolution never to refuse an alms to any poor person that asked him. St. Stephen's excellent code of laws, to this day the basis of the laws of Hungary, are inscribed to his son, Duke Emmerich. In 55 chapters, the pious legislator has comprised the wisest and most holy regulations of the state. He pathetically exhorts his son to sincere humility, which he calls the sole exaltation of a king, to patience, meekness, assiduous and devout prayer, charity, compassion for the poor, the protection of all that are in distress, and more. He forbids, on pain of severe punishment, all grievous public crimes, especially of impiety and irreligion, as a violation of the Sunday or a fast day, talking in the church, a culpable neglect to call in the priest to assist dying persons, and more. He commands the most religious respect to be paid to all holy things and to the clergy. These wholesome laws he caused to be promulgated throughout his dominions, and had them always most strictly observed. The protection of his people engaged him sometimes in war, wherein he was always victorious. The Prince of Transylvania, his cousin, invaded his dominions. St. Stephen defeated him in battle, and made him prisoner, yet gave him his liberty, and restored him his dominions, requiring of him this only condition, that the gospel should be allowed to be freely preached in them. The saint was never the aggressor in any war. That with the Bulgarians was obstinate, but they were at length overcome, and obliged to receive the laws which he prescribed them. There is no saint whose virtue is not exercised by tribulation. Sickness deprived St. Stephen of all his children. St. Emmerich, the eldest, was carried off the last. He had then begun to sustain a great part of the burden of the state, and to be both a comfort and assistance to his father. The interest of the state and that of the infant church of his kingdom conspired with nature to make this stroke more severe, but the good king bore the loss with entire resignation, adoring in it the holy will of God. St. Emmerich was canonized by Benedict IX, and is honored among the saints on the 4th of November. This affliction weaned the king's heart more and more from the world, and he desired, if it had been possible, to reserve to the care of his own soul the remaining part of his life, that being freed from all worldly concerns, he might be preparing for his last passage. But as the affairs of both the church and state did not allow this, he continued to endure the toil of business, knowing that he was accountable to God for the least neglect or omission in the particular duties of his station towards his Creator, his subjects, or himself. Though brave and expert in war, he had always been a lover of peace, but from this time he took a resolution to spill no blood in war, in which he earnestly begged the interposition of divine providence, which did not fail him. For to hostilities he, after this, opposed no other arms than fasting, prayers, and tears, and by them alone was ever victorious. After the death of our saint's good friend, St. Henry, the emperor, his successor, Conrad II, invaded Hungary with a powerful army in 1030, and advanced so far that Stephen was compelled to lead out his army against him, though still trusting in God that the effusion of blood would be prevented. All things seemed to be disposed for a decisive battle when St. Stephen again recommended himself and his earnest desire of peace to the Blessed Virgin, and to the surprise of all men, the emperor, on a sudden, turned his back with his army, and without having executed anything, marched home into Germany with as great precipitation as if he had been defeated. St. Stephen labored 3 years under a complication of painful distempers. The saint, perceiving that his last hour drew near, assembled his nobles and recommended to them the choice of a successor, obedience to the Holy See, and the practice of Christian piety. He then again commended his kingdom to the patronage of the Blessed Virgin, and after having received the sacraments of penance, the viaticum, and extreme unction, happily expired on the feast of the Assumption of Our Lady, the 15th of August, in 1038, being 80 years old, of which he had reigned 41 from the death of his father, and 38 from the time he had been crowned king. His sacred remains were honored with miracles, and 45 years after his death, by an order of the Pope, at the request of the Holy King St. Ladislaus, were enshrined and placed in a rich chapel, which bears his name, within the great church of Our Lady at Buda. He was canonized by Benedict IX in the manner described by Benedict XIV. Innocent XI anointed his festival on the 2nd of September in 1686 with an office for the whole church. The Emperor Leopold having on that day recovered Buda out of the hands of the Turks, after many signal victories over those infidels. In Hungary, his chief festival is kept on the 20th of August, the day of the translation of his relics.